Hey, welcome to the podcast, everybody. Thanks for joining me. Appreciate it. After a little break, not a break from the daily grinds of work, but a break from the a full week of trading. The stock market was only open 3 days this week, and just as soon as it got started on Wednesday, it ended. Here we are on Friday afternoon. The markets are closed, and of course, the market was closed Monday and Tuesday for the storm. Hadn't seen that in quite a while. And everybody was expecting major fireworks on Wednesday. And, of course, the major fireworks came on Thursday and Friday. And we'll get into that in just a minute. Let's run through some of the numbers here. Dow Jones down 140 points after an upbeat jobs report. Transports down 1%. NASDAQ down 1%. S&P down 1%. Semiconductors down almost 2%. Russell 2000 and midcaps down 1.5%. Utilities holding up a little better than the market, only down 66 basis points. And financials holding up very well also. And we'll get into that in just a minute. Volatility, of course, picked up. Interest rates up and the dollar up. So that's your recap for the day. All right, before we get started, I just want to, again, welcome those that are new. We're getting a lot of people signing up on the website, carleggers.com, eggerscapital.com. Both go to the same place where you can sign up for the podcast. So every time we do a blog article or we have a podcast or video podcast, it comes right in your inbox. We don't bombard you with a bunch of stuff. Probably on average, maybe we do, I don't know, a couple of different articles or a couple of podcasts a week. So it's just enough to keep you in touch with what's going on in the markets. And we always like your feedback. So if you'd like to have any questions submitted to me, go ahead and reply straight to the email. I'll go ahead and answer those on a future podcast, or sometimes I'll just email straight back to you with those answers. So feel free to do that. Also, we're on Twitter, twitter.com/Carl Eggers, giving updates throughout the day. And we're on Facebook, of course, Google Plus, all those different places. So go check that out. Anyways, thanks for joining me. Appreciate it. So here we are, the S&P 500. I drew this little extension on the end here last podcast, just saying that's the 200-day moving average, and there's a reasonable chance that we eventually come down to that. You know, we didn't quite get fully exhausted, meaning that during this sell-off that we're seeing right in here, the stock market didn't quite get down to just one of those levels where you feel like everybody's tossing in the towel and there's a little panic. And typically, corrections, which I do ultimately think this will be, I think this correction ends on more panic. Today wasn't really panic. It was a bad day, but it wasn't a panic day. And I think you need a few days like today piled up. And we had a couple of them, you know, back in here when it broke down below the 50-day moving average. But once we, you know, turned the corner here, we had that big up day yesterday. It takes some of that away. So you really need that panicky day. You can see it down here in June, real bad down day. And that was kind of the end. And it was kind of a V bottom, and up we went from there. That's how these markets typically bottom, whether they're going through a correction or a bear market, is it looks like the shape of a V. And once it does that V, then it's off to the races. It looks like this. Whereas, you know, you tend to get more of a rounding effect when you get the market rolling over, something like this. That's a rounding effect, whereas here you had a V. So we didn't quite get there. However, we were getting pretty close to an oversold condition, and we had a little pop yesterday. And actually, nobody really knew what was going to happen. And I think part of the reason was the ADP. But then you also had the fact that it didn't sell off Wednesday, coming off of essentially what was a four-day weekend. Nobody could trade, light volume. You thought, who knows what's going to happen on Wednesday. And the market was very calm. And because of that, maybe there was some confidence that came in Thursday. Now, today, we saw that the jobs report came in better than expected. Now, there was more jobs added. However, the unemployment rate went up. And for those that are new, that simply means the reason that happened is more people started looking. And that's what you would expect. When you're having any type of recovery, the more people come start looking for jobs, obviously they get added back to the workforce. So the fractions change, and then unemployment actually goes up a little bit in the interim. That's what you're seeing right now. But the bottom line is we're still at 8% unemployment. Not a very healthy job market. Perhaps the market was digesting that. So even though it beat expectations, we still need 250,000 to 300,000 a month, you know, to really maintain the population growth and to get this economy growing again. And we're obviously not anywhere near there. So, you know, politicians, TV pundits, bloggers, whoever you're following may try to spin it either way positive, way negative. The bottom line is there is some job growth. You can see housing has at least sustained itself to where it's not falling anymore. The stocks have proven that. And so there is some activity. Unfortunately, there's still way too many people on food stamps. There's way too many people that are underemployed. Almost 15% of the workforce is what they call underemployed. So they're just not, they're either not at the jobs that they would like, or and so they're not earning their full capacity, or they're part-time instead of full-time. And one thing we've been seeing lately is that there are a lot of companies out there that are essentially reducing full-time workers to part-time. One of the reasons that they're doing that is Obamacare is going to mandate that if you have over 50 employees and those employees are working over 30 hours a week, you have to get them health insurance. So what a lot of companies are doing is saying, well, let's go ahead and if we have over 50 employees, which a lot of companies do, let's make a lot of them, as many of them as we can, part-time, then we can get around that and we'll have them work under 30 hours a week. So again, those aren't conditions that are great to grow this economy. So I don't know if today was about all of that. Today was simply the fact that, you know, again, we're coming into the election. It's on Tuesday. I did vote today. Not going to get political. Most of you probably can guess how I voted. But the bottom line is I did vote today. Tuesday's the election. And what's going to happen is the market is trying to bogey whether or not Obama gets in there or Romney gets in there. Now, some of you that want Romney in there would say, boy, if he gets in there, this market's really going to take off. And maybe ultimately in the long run, it's definitely pro-growth, and that would help. But let's not forget what a lot of this run we've gone through in the last, you know, several months has been about. The reason that a lot of this has happened is because of QE3 and Fed stimulus and zero interest rate policy. Those are the reasons why the stock market continues higher. That's not good, right? We need it to be going up because earnings are much better, profits are much better, less regulation, companies are hiring, people are motivated to go spend, invest. Those things aren't really present right now, and so that's what's made this market tough, and that's why, you know, being on the more conservative side, which I've done for most of this year, you know, hasn't paid off as much as people that have taken more risk because of the fact that you have gotten this market going up based on this friendly Fed. And so the fear is that if Mitt Romney gets in there, he may take some of that punch bowl away and the parents would come home to the party and take over. And so the market may be, you know, struggling right here because what's been happening? Well, that debate, the first Romney-Obama debate went well for Romney. Ever since then, the market's kind of been struggling. So in addition to that, what you're getting is you're getting the U.S. dollar turning up as well. And the U.S. dollar going up, while again, good in the long run, not good for stocks in the short run. So that's been happening. Gold's been pulling back, and stocks have been gyrating all around. So, you know, as far as the election's concerned, it's hard to say what the market will look like 3, 6, or 9 months from now, depending on who gets in. If Obama gets in, we know what we're going to get. And the market likes that certainty. Whether it's bad or not, it likes the certainty. What it doesn't like is the uncertainty. So that's probably what's going on right now, a little jockeying for position. And then you throw the storm on top of this, and now you say, well, how are the economic numbers going to look? We don't know, because obviously that storm hurt the economy. People can't even buy gasoline because there's not enough power to get to the pumps to pump the gasoline. So they can't get gasoline, so the gasoline stations are struggling because they're not open, a lot of them. People aren't going to work. They're not as productive. On the flip side, there's going to be a bunch of rebuilding. So how does that, what does it offset each other? We don't know. So again, you have some of that going on as well. And it's right at the time that the election's right around the corner. We still have the fiscal cliff, you know, which could hurt the economy in January. So all of these things are still on investors' minds. And that's why, even though the economic data you would think would have got the market rocking and rolling today, it didn't, because, again, too much good data is a bad thing, because those greedy Wall Street guys, they want zero interest rates and free money forever, as far as the eye can see. And while they have that right now, they may not have that come January. So that's why I think the stock market is struggling right now. Bottom line is, there's a couple of things that you should be, or well, let's go ahead and say should be doing, which is, again, looking at the portfolio from this 30,000 foot view at your own portfolio and looking at a day like today and saying, how did my portfolio react? And if your portfolio reacted unfavorably, not to say it had a minus sign in front of it, because look, when the market's down 140 points, there's a good chance you may lose money on a day like today. But in general, when you look at it, how much did you lose on a percentage? Why did you lose the money you lost? You know, are you weighted too heavily into those cyclical names that got beat up? Are you weighted too heavily on the good days in consumer staples and things like that don't move? What do you own? And for me, what I own is I did sell my energy today, but I am in financials. Financials, and you saw today, they held up very well. They were only down 50 basis points, and you can see this move that they've been on. Not necessarily that they have been, the market bottomed in June as well, but lately here, they've really outperformed the S&P. And if we look at all the major sectors and all the major ETFs out there, big broad ones, financials are ones that are leading the way. So they're beating the S&P. So you look for outperformance. Energy, on the other hand, has been underperforming. And so basically wanted to stop that out, and it got stopped out this afternoon. So when that gets stopped out, it has to go. So there's a part of the portfolio that we want in the things that are outperforming, right? And you can use ETFs for that. And you own that piece. And then we talked about, you know, in previous podcasts, owning these things that are deep values. And, in the past, I've owned companies like Eli Lilly, which I don't own anymore. But when it took this ramp up, we sold it. Once it started to pull back, and now you can see it's pulling back even further, it may come back into play where it is a deep value. It's actually at a spot right now that's fairly interesting because it's sitting at its 50-day moving average. But this is a valuation play. This is a company you look at and say, is it cheap for the cash flow we're getting? I'm doing that with Microsoft, and Microsoft's been in the news a lot lately, and obviously Microsoft has been all over the map and had a nice run late last year into early this year, and we took profits on it, and now we're back in it. And look, you got a company that's got almost 3.5% dividend yield, tons of free cash flow, new operating system, new tablet, and are they the best? No, they're not the best. I disagree with a lot of stuff they're doing, but again, they're a big enough player in the game, and they're a cheap stock. When you look at what you're getting in cash flow and all of that, you are getting a good deal. And so I can be patient with that. But I don't want a whole portfolio full of Microsofts. But that's the idea of having some things that yin when other things are yanging. Then, of course, we go to the good old-fashioned income-producing investments. And those could be various types of REITs. Those could be preferred stocks. Those could be strategic types of bonds. All those things are still working as well because, again, when the market's selling off like it is, interest rates, while they may be going up, they're not going up a lot. In fact, if we look at the 10-year treasuries, you know, they've been meandering up, but they're still at a very low level, 1.7%. And so because the economy is, you know, mediocre at best, interest rates are staying at this low level. So something we have to watch. And with the market down today, you would have expected money to flow into bonds. But the thing is that, again, I pointed this out last time, the correlation with stocks and bonds is where it's been opposite of each other is starting to break down a little bit on particular days. Today was one of those. You wouldn't have expected interest rates up. You would have expected interest rates down with money flowing out of stocks into bonds. That didn't happen. So given that, you know, we need to watch that. But the idea that interest rates are still low means there's a lot of income-producing investments that work. So on a day like today, you're still making money because that income's just building up and it's ready to pay you. So you put all those things together with some cash, and obviously you can go pick some companies, whether they're based on the charts or the fundamentals for shorter-term trades. And when you put those things together, I think that's how, again, you manage this environment right now. I'm not betting on the market, and I'm not making a big prediction that the market's going to go, you know, straight up after the election or straight down after the election. I don't know, and I don't think you know, and I don't think anybody on TV knows. And the thing is, you know, the election could be a non-event. Imagine that. Why would I say such a dumb thing? Because it just may. And we don't know. I mean, look, you thought Wednesday may have been a big event, and it was a non-event. So everybody's thinking that it's going to be a huge event. Maybe it's a non-event. I don't know. But I don't want to be positioned too heavily one way or the other. But I feel pretty comfortable right now going into the election positioned the way I am. You know, if you look at the S&P right here, you know, it kind of broke down a little bit below this. And if we go back to the S&P 500 on the, not the ETF, but the actual index, again, you can see I've drawn this, you know, extension of this 200-day moving average. And it wouldn't surprise me in the least bit for us to go down there again, maybe even post-election, and then maybe that's a good place to bounce. So that's what's going on with the overall market. Again, you know, if you see something working but you don't want to increase your allocation, prune out or cull out the weak part of the portfolio, as I did with energy, and stay in the strong part of the portfolio, like I am with financials and some of those other areas. All right, let's move on to probably the biggest topical stock in the market right now, which is Apple Inc., and it is one that I own. And, of course, you know, I think many people, whether you're following Twitter, watching interviews on TV, of course, everybody doesn't own it right now, right? While it's going down, nobody owns it. Everybody sold it at the top at 700. And now, when it bottoms out at some point, everybody will have picked the bottom just perfectly. Bottom line is this. I think with Apple, and I wrote an article yesterday on CarlEggers.com, you probably saw it, regarding Apple. And I went through, as unbiased as I could, being that I am a shareholder, but I went through as unbiased as I could all the negatives and all the positives of Apple right now. And, you know, it had its first 10% plus down month since 2008. So it's a big deal. It's not that it's just, you know, a little bit of vibration. It's going through a correction right now. And I laid out some of the corrections or some of the reasons for the correction. But the thing I wanted to point out is I think you have to make a decision. And I didn't really put this in the article, but you have to make a decision with Apple whether you're going to trade it or whether you're an investor. And I think you should really do that with a lot of stocks you own, because there are stocks, and Apple is one that you could trade, but most people that have traded it have been penalized for doing so. I had made over 100% in it, sold it, it went up further, and then I bought it back, you know, and made even more on it. So I would have been better off not selling it. But the point is, yes, if you would have sold at 700, are you better off? Yes, you're better off than you know, keeping it down here at $576.95. But the bottom line is it's going through a correction, and I laid out some of those reasons, things like, oh, the management shakeup, and obviously, you know, the pricing of the iPad mini and all these reasons. I'm not going to go through the whole article. You can go look at it on CarlEggers.com. But the bottom line is this, that it started the stock started to roll over when their revenue and their earnings growth started to slow down a little bit. So what you do is you don't just look at their earnings and say, well, they were earning $10 a share last quarter, and this quarter they're earning $11, and the next quarter they're earning $12. Well, they're going up. Stock should be going up. No, it's about what is the percentage change between those numbers. And what happened is the percentage change started to come down a little bit, and so Apple is now adjusting for that slowdown. It is happening. It's real. But let's take a snapshot as of today, you know, sub $600, and look at what's going on. They have a PE ratio that's approaching 12. So again, this is not, you know, the key here is this is not the tech.com bubble of 2000. You know, back then, you had companies that had PE ratios of, you know, 100, 150, meaning it would take you 150 years to get your money back as far as your profits based on what you're paying for the stock. And so, yes, when their growth would slow, the stocks would just get slammed. This is not that case. Apple is going down because of a slowdown a little bit. But if you look at the estimates going out forward, and we've done a lot of work on it, if you look out further than just tomorrow, they're going to actually reaccelerate. So it's kind of like coming to a traffic light, and you're just about to slow down, and all of a sudden the light turns green, and you put on the accelerator again. Apple's earnings and revenue will do that. Now, again, is Apple losing some of its luster? Maybe, and that's in question. And so people that have owned it a long time may be going, maybe the best is over. But let's just take it from where it is today. And again, you have a company that has $120 billion in cash. They have a PE ratio of 12. They're going to earn over $46 a share in earnings this year. Don't forget they pay a dividend now. They've already sold off, you know, about 15% from the high, 18% now, including today from the high. They're below their 200-day moving average. People are panicking, but again, if you look at something like their long-term picture here, going back to 2009, you know, this is still vibration. It's a big move, especially if you're somebody that bought at $700. You're going, uh-oh. But again, this is when you leave your powder dry a little bit so you can take advantage of it when it bottoms. And it will. It is a, and I've mentioned this before, it's more of a cult stock. It's everybody loves it, and it could do no wrong. It's still a company, and they're going to make mistakes. And but when you look across the landscape of what they're doing, they still dominate what they do. And that's very important. They dominate what they do. And, you know, now they're in a different price level with this iPad mini, and the stock is corrected. So again, after the correction, now you take a rational look at it and say, is it worth, you know, going in and buying at this level? I'm not saying today is the day to buy it. It could come down a little further. If we go back, you know, go back here. I mean, I don't know what the magical level is, but you know, this would be the logical spot, 524. Boy, people would really be panicking. Another $50. That's another 10%. But the bottom line is you have to make your decision whether you're an investor in the company or whether you are somebody that wants to trade it. A company that I've watched over the years, I've never bought it, but a company, Rackspace, it's actually here in San Antonio, in my hometown. I live a little outside of San Antonio, but the thing is with Rackspace, this is a company that, a very fast-growing company. It's not a cheap stock. It's not one you'd go in there and say, boy, this is a great deal at $66 a share. But the thing is, if you look at this, you know, this was a stock that was $60, went all the way down to 40. Okay, that's a 33% decline. And so, again, had you panicked out and sold there, look what's happened now. Now it's $66. So, and I know people that are original investors in this company. And those people, they don't sit there and watch the stock on a daily basis and make trades based on what's going. What they do is they evaluate the business to decide if they want to sell it, and they have tax consequences, but they're investors. They're real investors in this, not just trading it. And again, there's nothing wrong with trading these things if that's what you want to do. And so as we go back to Apple, if you want to trade it, sure, it got a little extended at $700, but bottom line, it wasn't expensive at $700, and it's not expensive at $576. But the reason for this decline has been because of the slowdown in the earnings growth and the revenue growth. And again, that it's still growing at a very fast clip. And compared to other companies, this is a nice, good company, and it's not expensive. So I'm just going to be patient with it. But again, if you're somebody that can't sleep at night because of Apple, you probably own too much of it. I don't own a lot of Apple. I own a small piece of it. But the idea is now that I can go in once it does bottom, take advantage of it, and I probably will at some point. So that's a quick summary on Apple. But when it did break its 200-day moving average today, interestingly enough, if you look at the 5-minute chart here, straight, once it broke through there, that's really when the market started to sell off even harder as well. And so if we go to the spiders, you can see that's that same spot there. So it really sold off. You know, whether that caused it or not, remember, Apple is still a big part of the overall market as far as the cap and the weighting and those types of things. So, but anyways, it is the headline stock of the day for sure. All right, everybody, don't forget, hey, buy blood in the streets and sell greed, right? And there's starting to become blood in the streets on particular stocks, and Apple's in the crosshairs. Have a wonderful weekend, and for those that are, you know, watch this podcast up in the Northeast. Thoughts and prayers with you. And probably you're not watching this because you still don't have power, but hopefully over the weekend you will get that power back. And everybody have a great day, and we'll talk to you soon.